any business and they would have heard of the age-old business mantra that says, customer is king. With the power to make or break a company, customers are the most important pedestal for any business. But as companies struggle to stay afloat during the pandemic, it may be time to question the very notion of putting customers before everyone or everything else. A new line of thought pushes the idea that an employees-first approach produces far better results. Employees driven by passion have a greater ability to help a company in a crisis compared to customers who can still be whimsical. Businesses where the management understands the importance of the work being done by the employees can overcome any mountain. Vineet Nayar, former CEO HCL Technologies and founder Sampark Foundation, says if businesses have to survive today, it needs to value its employees. Only when employees are fascinated by their assignments, jumping out of their skins with excitement about what's next, and eagerly pursuing better solutions and new initiatives, can a company truly prosper.
Thank you, Mr. Nayar, for joining us today, and welcome to ET Rise Dialogues. My first question to you would be, according to you, how have Indian companies handled this crisis? Can you even prepare for something like this?
That's an interesting question. Indian companies were like rowing in a still lake, and the emphasis of the leadership and the boards at that particular time was to improve productivity, improve efficiency, and to make sure that every single team member is rowing in sync. And therefore, everybody was aligned to that focus. Suddenly, there was a storm, and now the skills which are needed to run the company are river rafting. The leadership, hence, went into a freeze, not knowing what to do. Then went to what I call self-preservation. They threw a lot of people off board because they thought that they will sink, and therefore a good number of people were thrown off board with an assumption that less is better. So they reduced costs, reduced inventory, reduced on people, reduced marketing budget. And then slowly they are reaching a stage today where they realize the river rafting needs a transformation of the company, needs new ideas, new innovation, new management capability, new way of dealing with employees, a new way of dealing with customers. And India Inc. is slowly coming around to thinking through that. So I think different companies fared very poorly to very well, depending on how quickly they came to phase three. And in circumstances like this, you can never prepare. But you always have to ask yourself the question is that leadership is tested in troubled times. If the times are not troubled, then why do you need a leader at all? And therefore, these are the time when the true mettle of the leaders have been tested. And I can tell you, 2 years down the line, a very large percentage of leaders who are running the companies today will not be there. They'll be replaced by more agile, more intuitive, more employee-friendly leaders who will navigate through these troubled times, which is going to last for a couple of years.
So in your observation, do you think it was the larger companies with more experienced management that seem to have done better? Or would you say that that's not a correct assumption and there are smaller companies as well which have done much better in this period?
I think overall, I would believe that larger companies have done less well, predominantly because larger companies froze into indecisions. And what really happens is when you get into a crisis situation, you tend to take decisions which are easy to take. The easy to take decisions are cost out decisions. The tougher decisions to take is to remodel your business completely and come up with new products, new way of working, new way of dealing with employees, a new way of dealing with customers. That is the tougher thing to do. Right. So larger companies actually take longer time to remodel themselves because they try to hang on to their old ways of doing things Everybody is set, and everybody is, as I said, rowing on a in a still lake. Smaller companies are entrepreneurial in nature, so they are anyway in the guerrilla warfare. They don't know what tomorrow looks like, and therefore, I believe they adopted to this model or this change dramatically better than the larger companies did.
Right. You have always followed what many would call, you know, a contrarian view, where you put employees first, even before customers. Why do you say so?
I think times like this, you know, need deep reflections. If you look at the birth of management practices, you can nail it down to the industrial age. Industrial age, which lasted quite a couple of decades, was the art. The management was the art of putting people together, so that you can produce more than what any individual can produce. And therefore, all our management practices around hierarchies, productivity, appraisal systems, increments, annual increments, employee satisfaction surveys, all that are what I call the industrial age management practices. And there, the role of leader, the role of manager, was to be able to put people together in rows and columns so that collectively they can produce higher output. About two decades ago, the internet became a dominant force in the world, and innovative companies started coming out and crossing market cap of the old age companies at a colossal pace. Therefore, from productivity, we move to innovation. And the organizations of tomorrow are those organizations which can innovate, come up with disruptive ideas which would outflank your competition. Now, the question these companies were asking is, what are the management practices which are required to innovate? Now, if you look at innovation, innovation is the art of doing what others consider impossible. Let me repeat that. Innovation is the art of doing what others consider impossible. And the only way you can do stuff impossible is by thinking outside the boundaries of logic and reason. Mm-hmm. Now, you cannot think outside the boundaries of logic and reason unless every single employee in the interface of the customer in your company is thinking outside the boundaries of logic and reason and is empowered to do that. So if you can potentially empower the employees, increase the clock speed, motivation level, enthusiasm level of the employees, and help the employees innovate by taking risk, by giving him blank canvas to paint, you cannot create what I call an innovative organization. So transformation of an organization can only happen if you become employee-centric by asking yourself three fundamental questions. What is the core business of your company? And I believe the answer of all these companies, including at HCL Technology Transformation Journey, which we led, was that we are in the business of creating unique experiences or unique value for our customers. Question number two is, who creates this unique experience or unique value for your customer? In obviously, the employees in the interface of the company and the customer. In this case, Economic Times is not creating value. You, as an employee of Economic Times, is doing the interview. And the quality of the interview will be purely dependent on how motivated, how innovative, and how enthusiastic are you about it. So the employees are the differentiation, are the employees are the core people who are creating the differentiation. Hence, the third and the most important thing, if the employees are the differentiator or creating the unique experiences which helps you grow faster, what should the role of managers and management be? The obvious answer in the industrial, in the innovation age, is that the role of managers and management can be nothing but enthusing, encouraging, enabling these employees to innovate, to create the differentiated value so that your companies can grow faster. That is the reason the role of the management is to put employees first, and the role of the employees is to put the customer first. When management says customer first and they ignore the employees, you're already seeing what is happening with a lot of Indian companies today. They're sacking employees left, right, and center. What is happening with Swiggy, where the, you know, delivery, the cost which you're paying to the employees is dramatically cut down. Obviously, when such demotivation sets into the employees, there is no way they will bring the best game to the picture. And there is no way you would be able to grow at the cost of employees. I think more and more companies in the Bay Area, which is Facebook and Google and Apple and everybody, has understood this the fact that if they wish to outmaneuver everybody else using innovation, then they have to be in employee-first zone where they are enthusing, encouraging, enabling, and that is the role of the leaders and the management. And that, in my mind, is most relevant in times of crisis. In times of crisis, the only set of people who can get you out of this logjam is not the CEO, is not the leadership team alone, but it is the employees. And if you can increase the clock speed of the employees and add new ideas, I think you will be out of this mess pretty soon.
So in a sense, you mean to say that, especially in a crisis, this employee first is even more important.
I started this conversation by giving you an example of rowing versus rafting.
Right.
When you are rowing, a single employee doesn't matter that much, predominantly because everybody is rowing in sync. So if somebody is rowing slower, faster, it doesn't make that much of a difference because you have many people rowing. In case of rafting, you know, you need everybody working on intuition. You can't hear each other. There are no instructions. There are no rule book. So the only reason every single employee is going to do what is required to save the boat is if that employee is motivated, if that employee is empowered, if that employee knows what needs to be done at that particular time and takes the risk to do it. That is the only way a river rafting boat survives. Now, you have to see your organization from the fact that you are in troubled times. And if you are in troubled times and the employee is looking up and saying, what should I do? You cannot river raft in that fashion. So you have to have an organization where the employee feels motivated, charged, sees this as an opportunity. You know, if you had the series of diamond cutters, you know, you were in diamond cutting industry. And if every single employee does not see an opportunity in a rough diamond and gets excited of what can I do with it, you will not be a great diamond cutting organization. Same is true with a potter. A potter gets excited with rough clay. Right. So I think we have to create an organization where every single employee is motivated, wants to climb Mount Everest every day, and is given the tools and training to do that, is empowered to do that. And once you create that kind of organization in such crisis time where what is the right step, nobody knows, and therefore you have to do series of experiments. This is the only way to do that. This is the only culture you need to create. And this is the only way you would be able to get out from the mess. Otherwise, you're dead.
Right. We've heard, you know, several leaders, especially in the tech world, including the likes of Satya Nadella, talk about empathy. So how much of employee first hinges on being empathetic?
I don't like the word empathy. The reason I don't like the word empathy is it gives power. It's that God syndrome, that leaders and CEOs are gods and therefore they are being empathetic to the employees as if they are doing employees a favor. Bullshit. You know, employees are the reason these organizations are where they are. And they and the management and they and the CEO, they and the board are at equal standing. Therefore, the question here in employee first, customer second is, can you run a great organization without enthused, excited, motivated, innovative employees? The answer is no. So you as shareholders, you as boards, you as CEO need the employees in a certain mindset to be able to create the billions and billions of dollars of value which you wish to create. So therefore, I would say empathetic to the employees is good. You know, it becomes very handy when you are thinking of sacking employees. But I would say you need to respect the employees. You need to understand they are your core asset. You need to understand they are your core differentiator. You need to invest in them. And you don't need to do a favor to them because they are doing a favor to you by being enthusiastic, innovative, motivated, and doing something which is impossible.
Right. So I think you briefly talked about it. You know, the kind of layoffs that we have seen both with established companies and, you know, the smaller startups. Do you think that could have been avoided? I mean, some say that, you know, it is a question of their survival, but could this have been avoided?
So, you know, there is no one answer to that. Obviously, the small and medium sector companies which went into cash jam, their cash was completely strapped because the customers were not paying, the banks were not giving loans, and they were in this, what I call the 2%, 5% margin. They had no choice but to reduce cost dramatically. And to survive, they had to get give a walkover to their employees. And I empathize with them because the employees can be hired back when the business comes back. And that I completely agree. But what my heart pains is that billions and billions of dollars are being invested in startups. And they have a cash pool which is lined up in the bank. Their marketing spend is more than their employee cost. And they decided to get rid of employees, which is mindless. And I will come to that in terms of why they are mindless. Number two, large organizations with large market cap and large profit pool in IT industry, in pharma industry, in many other industry, where they have, you know, the balance sheets are pretty strong. This was the time for you to go to the employees and say, no employee left behind. At Sampark Foundation, we are a very small organization. We work with 90,000 schools and impact 1 crore children. But I did announce on day one of lockdown is that we will not sack or reduce the salary of a single employee. Why? Because I could afford it, right? So when you can afford it, if you say that to your employee, then employee is going to work 10 times harder for you. The third thing, which I think very, very many people are making a mistake, is that even if you get rid of 10, 15, 20% of your employee base, the issue is not the savings which you accrue from the 20% sacking of employees. It is the impact of demotivation of the 80% who have stayed back in the company. So the clock speed of that 80% goes down to 50%. By getting rid of 20%, you've actually destroyed the value of the organization. So that is the reason I said the easy decisions for lazy leaders is to take these short-term decisions, which appear to be as saving costs and being very smart, but actually destroy the long-term value of the company. The gutsy leaders and the smart leaders who have invested in the long-term future of the company think before taking such actions, because the future of any company is purely in the hands of how motivated your employees.
Right. So what according to you has the crisis meant for leaders and management of companies?
I would believe it, you know, I'll answer that question by telling you a story that there was a very rich man who called a plumber to his house. And John the plumber came and this rich man sat him down and started talking about the house, that this house was built 800 years ago. And this is the seat when Nelson Mandela sat, and this is where Mahatma Gandhi was, and this painting was done by Michelangelo, a very proud owner of the house. And for 1 hour, he kept on talking about, you know, how beautiful the house was. And after 1 hour, he looked at John and saying, John, what do you think? And John turned to him and says, that's all good, but where the hell is the leak? So the issue here is that the first lesson this crisis has taught is that when there is a crisis, get to the truth very quickly. Don't beat around the bush. Don't tell how you will survive. Don't say that you are the strongest, you are the largest, you are number one. Don't do all of that. Get to the truth very quickly. Get the truth to employees very quickly and take out an ad in the newspaper saying we are looking for plumbers. Because plumbers get excited by leaks, and we have a lot of leaks today. And we want employees who are excited by this crisis and are willing to get into the storm to help us solve it. So that's the first lesson in terms of you need to focus on the problems and by making it our problem, not my problem. Number two, this is a time to motivate the organization. So the leader should be out there, not hiding in the house behind Zoom. Leaders should be communicating. Leaders should be making the employees safe and secure so that the clock speed of the organization goes up. The third learning is the fact that, you know, if you keep on asking the old questions which you asked before the crisis, you will come up with the old answers which you came up with before the crisis. The crisis is asking you different sets of questions, and those questions need different sets of answers. So you need to go to the blackboard and erase everything you know about your business. And you need to rewrite all the assumptions. You need to do design thinking. You need to rewrite all the assumptions. And you need to come up with new answers to old questions and new answers to new questions. And you need to solve that innovatively. If you do that, that will get you out of the situation. And the third and the last, you must understand the difference between leaders and managers. Managers count value. Managers are motivators. Managers are in accumulation. Leaders create value. Leaders are built of material which leads team to do stuff which others consider impossible. When a crisis comes in, a leader is tested. So thank God there is a crisis, because this is the time you can demonstrate that you are a person apart. And therefore, get excited about it. Get your team excited about it, that this is an opportunity for us to demonstrate that we are better than others. So you are heading into a dark tunnel. Nobody can see. So press the accelerator, because all your competition would be pressing brakes. And if you do that, you will succeed. So I think these are some lessons which the corona crisis is throwing our way. Some leaders will learn from it. Some leaders will hide under the table and be dead pretty soon.
Thank you so much, Mr. Nayar, for talking to us. It's been a real pleasure, and you have laid out beautifully some of the key things that management and leadership, I think, across India, both in bigger and smaller companies, should take note of. Again, thank you so much for talking to us.
Thank you. Take care. Bye-bye.